Welcome to the 10 Pin Bowling Show. This week we have a Baker Teams match between 10 Pin City and Interbowl. Now down to our commentators.
And welcome back to the 10 Pin Bowling Show's continuing coverage of the 2010 New South Wales State League Big Clash. From Lidcombe, New South Wales, our two teams, 10 Pin City and Interbowl. Our 10 Pin City team consists of Glenn Rowland, Jason Osborne, Andrew Lloyd, Matt Riley, and Glenn Loader.
And for Team Interbowl, the veteran Kevin Webb, Christian Perdue, recently inducted into the Australian team, Sam Cooley at three, Daniel Webbers at four, and at the anchor position is Dale Fitzgerald.
And 10 Pin City take a 9-8 game lead, leading into this Baker format match. It is the first team to 13 wins. We'll take away that lovely piece of silverware you see in the background, viewers.
And Interbowl looking for a win here. They've been behind basically all the way through, just a game or two. And that's not going to help.
Oh, that's a terrible break for Interbowl. Christian Perdue has the high shot there and leaves a 4-9 stone cold.
Bit of banter there between the teams. Taking out the plastic ball here. Have a suspicion. First frame, you might go for this.
Would do no harm. Oh, very, very close.
Good effort, that one, but it's an open frame. And there it is in close-up.
Close-up of the trophy. Looks like a magnificent piece of silverware.
I'm sure the winning chain will display it proudly, and they'll have bragging rights for 12 months.
12 months is a long time to get your revenge. Now, opening up for 10 Pin City is Jason Osborne. He has six perfect games to his credit, and a three-game series of 8-0-7.
That's not the start he was after. Jason, if he makes a mistake, he gets the ball down too early, and it invariably creeps through the nose. Going to go back, take his medicine, take two.
Yeah, do the best thing for the team here.
And it's an even match. Pair of splits.
Yeah, got to remember that we're bowling in a five-man team. Each bowler gets two frames to do their best for their side. And look, if you throw a bad frame, you've got to take the most amount of pins you can for your team. Every pin counts here in this format. Daniel Webb, bowling for Interbowl. He is just 17 years of age and has a perfect 300 game to his credit. Holds a current league average of 210, if you don't mind.
Pretty impressive, and that wasn't a bad shot first up. Have a look here. Really firm through the bottom of the swing. Big follow through. Got right through that one. Slight adjustment, and he'll be spot on.
Yeah, it's a very, very confident shot to start with, Daniel. Leaving the 4-7. See if he can spare that up.
Whoa.
Oh, it's in trouble.
Whoa. Big mistake.
No good. No good from Daniel Webb. As you can see here, he's missed well right of target. And the hard case plastic does not turn.
It's almost like he forgot he had the plastic ball in his hand.
Now, Glenn Rowland.
Recall Glenn last week. Finished his match very confidently with this ball.
Oh, he's continued his form.
He has.
Fantastic shot. Just digging the 10 pin out.
You can see why that he was searching around late in the match last week. Wanted to have something so he could contribute in this match. And thus far he has. Big shot.
And you've only got two frames to contribute and one of them's a strike. Sensational. Now Kevin Webb for Team Interbowl. He's 58 years young and has been bowling for 45 of those years. Has 16 perfect 300 games to his credit. He'd like to open with one, but
the ball climbs high again. Condition might just be starting to break down. Yeah, most shots at the moment have gone a bit high. Only Glenn Rowland has flushed the pocket so far. Everyone else either been high pocket or through the nose. We get quite a few matches. The condition starts to break down.
Yeah, starts to deteriorate a bit. Takes the spare. Kevin Webb, and you don't get a 222 league average by leaving those behind. Very well done.
You've got to throw a lot of strikes to average 222 if you're not throwing any spares.
Now, Andrew Lloyd is the lone left-hander on the telecast today.
Lone left-hander from either team.
He should have a significant advantage. The left side should be a lot fresher. We'll have a look.
This is one occasion where I'll agree with you that left-handers have an advantage.
It would be a lot more often than that, guarantee you that. But that's a fantastic shot. That's high flush in the pocket. Ball taken care of the eight on the way through.
It was a good-looking shot, that one. Looks like he just found the oil line there. Sat along the oil line. Nicely done.
But he's doubled up for 10-pin City, and that's the most important thing.
They have quite a sizable lead now. Dale Fitzgerald, he was impressive last week. Let's see what he can do here.
Plenty of speed.
Bit too much speed, I would suspect.
Yeah, that was the one thing that let him down late last week, was the speed was getting a little bit too high. He was hitting that 7 or 8 board and just washing through.
It looks like the ideal speed for him on this condition is just a little bit slower than natural. What's natural for him? He's a hair outside his comfort zone. Really needs to go for this. Got to get it to the left side. And dead.
Great spare. I'll tell you what, if he didn't spare that, they were in big, big trouble.
But it's the sort of spare that can lift a team. They're struggling. They've had a couple of opens. The opposition's got a double. You know, a spare like that's the sort of thing that can get the adrenaline up a little bit, raise their spirits.
Yeah, get the guys going. Now, Matt Riley for 10-pin City. Here's a lot of power coming up. Oh.
That 6-pin's just flown around the 10.
Didn't leave a lot behind, did it? I like the shot. I like the angles he's playing. Probably a little bit too much angle in the end.
Yeah, a little too much angle. Probably maybe just a hair late with the break point. I reckon that that's coming just a hair behind the head pin. Bring that break point, you know, maybe only 2-3 feet back towards him. And that's 10 in the pit.
Now look, Matt's bowling cold as well. He hasn't been on the telecast for quite some time. So we'll see a little bit more of him in a few more frames.
A lazy 226 league average.
It's not bad, is it? 18,300 games to go. Sam Cooley bowling for Team Interbowl. He's their anchor bowler, and he will have the 10th frame.
He's been impressive in this telecast. Right through this tournament, Sam's just, you know, at times when it's looked like he would struggle, he's been the strength of the Interbowl team, I think.
He's been very, very good, no doubt about that. And it's shots like that holds him in high esteem amongst his colleagues.
You can see why he's the anchor bowler.
Now Glenn Loader from 10-pin City. He has an opportunity to extend the lead. He's gone very wide.
And he's the only bowler who's been able to. Yeah, he's been able to get out there, swing it really wide and get it back where no one else has been able to. That one read way early. Whether it was a bit soft on the speed, I'm not sure, but
he manages to get down and hit the ball so hard, and he's worked it to a, such a fine art now, where he can get it within a microsecond, and he's got the perfect rotation.
Yeah, but it's a very clean rotation, very clean release.
Spare time. Oh, wasn't very confident,
yeah,
but
and he knew it.
He took the spare. We'll be right back after this short message.
I'm Larissa Brosnan, and you're watching the 10-pin Bowling Show.
And welcome back, all viewers, to this week's edition of the 10-pin Bowling Show, covering the 2010 New South Wales State League Big Clash.
We've reached the turn, and basically we have 21-pin match. 10-pin City with that 21-pin lead. If Christian Perdue can eat into that with a double.
Oh! I like that carry.
That'll love that carry after what happened to him in the first frame.
Oh, yeah.
That was actually, if anything, a hair higher.
It's got to raise the spirits a bit, though. He's knocked out the split.
And as much as Inderbowl has struggled, it's back to an 11-pin match.
Yeah, it's closed right up by virtue of that double. Now, Jason Osborne, see if he can improve on his first show. He left the big four.
Needs to get the ball out a little bit. That's a better looking shot, I think. Oh, even that one went high. Shows you how much I know.
Oh, no. The ball did end up in the left-hand pocket.
Have a look at that. A little bit further out on the lane, but yeah, that was just inside target. All the way.
I think really took off at the back. And I can understand why you'd get confused with the left-hand pocket being the correct one.
Not biting. Not biting.
Oh, come on, just a little one?
Nah, I've got too much rubbish for being a left-hander over the years. Learn not to bite. Now, whoa, that's a big one out the window.
He threw a really good shot first time up. The second one, I think he just lost it off the hand.
That was an anxious shot, that one. That one, there was a bit of anxiety in that shot. Desperate to get the turkey, bring it back to a one-pin match. Put the pressure on 10-pin sitting.
What would you do here? Go for the three?
Oh, in that situation, wash out, you definitely go for it. The only time you wouldn't go for it is if you only need, you know, if you need three for a win. It would be the only time that you would not try and convert that spare. Well, Daniel's done for the day, and unfortunately a couple of opens, but it's all part of learning experience for the young fella.
It's all part of being part of a Baker format as well.
Absolutely.
You've got the five guys, you all got to work together, get as many pins as you can. Now, Glenn, see if he can keep his wild ride going.
And this one's not easy either. The three and the sleeper nine.
Particularly for the right-hander, this is a very difficult spare. And the way that Glenn has been missing inside makes it even more difficult.
It does. Now he's moved left on the approach using the same ball. This is a good strategy. A lot of people go for this with the plastic ball, and that really cuts down your margin for error.
Oh, looks good.
That's a great shot.
Notice he was a lot more open on this swing as well. He freewheeled it at the bottom. He didn't grab at it. He just let the ball take its course, hit the target, and perfect spare.
Quite often happens when you're not trying to knock over 10. you're not trying to knock over 10, so you tend to just not over-rotate as much. You stay behind the ball, cleaner with the release. You end up actually getting a much better reaction.
It's a case of the second ball first, isn't it?
Quite often. Kevin Webb now.
Oh no. Terrible break.
Another 4-9 for Inderbowl.
Well, in their attempts to draw level in the ledger, they haven't done too badly, but it's breaks like this, and they've had it twice now. It's been quite unfortunate. And at this point in the match, he has to spare this.
Has to go for it.
Has to spare it.
It's just, it's just, you know, critical now that he goes back and tries to get this. He's given it a run, not quite far enough left. And it's a pretty disconsolate looking group in the Inderbowl, on the Inderbowl bench now.
There are a few forlorn looks on the bench, aren't there?
There are.
Yep, as you can see, viewers.
And they're in a position now really where they're reliant on 10-pin City slowing down and waiting for them. Because the best they can get from here is 175. Whereas 10-pin City, they're on a 195 pace.
Andrew taking plenty of time with his second shot. A loft at the front end of the lane.
Quite often you get that extra loft. It does two things. It takes the oil from the front part of the lane out of play, and it also decelerates your ball speed a little bit. So it actually can create slightly earlier and heavier break. It could quite possibly hit target, but the extra loft
makes the ball break a bit sooner.
When you take the head oil out of play, absolutely. And that's been Andrew's problem in this tournament, is the consistency of his loft. Anyway, we'll be back with the conclusion of this match after this short break.
And welcome back to this week's edition of the Ten Pin Bowling Show. We've got the conclusion of the 2010 New South Wales State League Big Clash from the Commonwealth New South Wales, Dale Fitzgerald.
And he's made a ball change.
Oh, he has made a ball change.
Much earlier rolling ball. Might suit his speed.
Oh.
Yeah, rolled too early.
Not a bad change, though, I think, given the situation Inner Bowl finds themselves in.
As I mentioned in his earlier frame, that I thought that the correct ball speed for him was maybe just a hair slower than what was natural for him. Going to a more aggressive ball, it was a logical step. Took the punt, it didn't quite pay off.
Saying he could probably afford to amp it up a little bit and he could find the pocket that way?
I would suggest so, but it didn't quite work for him. And that's his day done for this particular match. Matt Riley now. Standing way left, he's going to swing this one out. Going to hit it with everything he can.
As Matt Riley generally does.
Big messenger. Big messenger.
Unfortunately, leave the 10 pin the first time on the lanes. This time. How about that?
He got that one down a bit earlier. He got that ball down a little bit earlier. Hit it with absolutely everything. Got the earlier break point. And that was the difference in the carry.
Yeah, great looking shot in any case. Now Sam Cooley, 18 years of age.
That's impressive. That is impressive.
That's why he's anchor bowler. That is a sensational shot. For guys that are swinging the ball from left to right and then back in, with the consistency that Sam had, I've been very impressed.
He certainly hasn't looked out of place.
More of the same.
That is a really impressive shot. And all right, they're out of the match. They can't win it, but you want to go out with good shots, and Sam certainly doing himself plenty of credit with this sort of finish.
Absolutely. Look, he's had seven perfect 300 games to his credit, so he knows where the pocket is.
That was down a bit early, went through the beak.
Didn't matter though. A couple of very good shots in the 10th frame, but Team Interbowl finished with a score of 162. It won't be enough. Not with Glenn Loader at the approach.
That's a winner.
Oh, sensational shot. The way these guys are swinging it and able to find the pocket, it's been really, really good to watch.
Even as the conditions deteriorated, the guys swinging the ball still seem to have a little bit of room to play with. It's the guys playing straight up who were struggling.
Whoa, ooh, that took off.
Boy. That one read really early.
Didn't know what. What was that I was saying? Wow. That sucker read really early.
Well, that took off enough to collect the Brooklyn pocket and pick up all 10. I think the Inner Bowl guys were enjoying that one as well.
Well, not much else they can do is just sit back and have a good laugh at it.
25-year-old Glenn Loader finishing it off the 10-pin city. Oh, high shot for a 9-pin. Some would count that as unlucky. But they have a 200 score. It's 38 pins better than Interbowl were able to manage. The handshakes all round. 10-pin city extend the lead, 10-8.
Thanks for your company today, and we look forward to seeing you next week. Good luck in bowling.